So in the last class, we've seen that Reynolds number scales as 1 upon epsilon square, or rather it is a way of saying epsilon square scales as 1 upon Reynolds number. There's nothing to say but delta goes as L upon square root of Reynolds number. So higher the Reynolds number, thinner will be the boundary layer. So let me draw a quick schematic. So this is delta and this is the free stream. So we have already looked at the continuity equation. So del u star del x star plus del v star del y star equal to 0. We've also looked at the form of the x momentum equation. U star del u star del x plus v star del u star del y is equal to minus del p star del x star plus del 2 u star del y 2. So this equation is after accounting for this particular scaling. So let us proceed to write down the scaling for the y momentum equation. So let us write down the equation in terms of the rescaled variable. So the rescaled variables, if you recall, V star will be V bar upon epsilon and Y star will be Y bar upon epsilon. So we are magnifying the small quantities, while we'll simply write X star as X bar and U star as U bar, similarly for pressure. So let us modify this equation. So it becomes, so this V bar will give us epsilon U bar del V bar upon del X bar. So all this should be stars. So U star epsilon del V star upon del X star plus V star. So there will be one epsilon over here, one epsilon because of this, and one epsilon coming from this, and this will be equal to minus del V star upon, so what is this going to be, epsilon del Y star plus 1 upon Re. So one epsilon will come from this, epsilon del 2 V star del X star 2 plus 1 upon epsilon square del 2 V star upon del Y star 2. So we've already seen that. In fact, let us simplify this further before making any simplifications. So all of this is epsilon. So we can divide everything by epsilon once again. So we have U star del V star del X plus V star del Y star is equal to minus 1 upon epsilon square del P star del Y star plus, so this epsilon will cancel with this guy, So it's 1 upon RE del 2 V star upon del X star 2 plus 1 upon epsilon square del 2 V star by del Y star 2. So in this particular equation, let us substitute the fact that RE scales as 1 upon epsilon square. In that case, this will be substituted by epsilon square. So the right hand side, it becomes minus 1 upon epsilon square del P star by del Y star plus epsilon square del 2 V star by del X star 2 plus del 2 V star upon del Y star 2. So the left hand side remains the same. Now let us look at which term will be the largest among these all. So this obviously is order 1. This is order 1 upon epsilon square. This is order epsilon square. So this is order 1. So obviously this term is much smaller than any of the order 1 terms. But this particular term is 1 by epsilon square order. So if when epsilon is very small, the magnitude of this particular term will be very large, and correspondingly this entire equation reduces to simply being 0 equal to, so okay, let us write down the equation, 0 equal to minus del P star del Y star. Okay, now you may say, wait, I mean, come on, you cannot just start neglecting all the terms, but in the leading order. So this equation, the main nature of this equation, in a broad sense, in a leading order sense, is governed by this. So this particular equation is known as the leading order equation. So it's like your, if you have a curve like this, okay, so this is the leading order behavior. And these oscillations are the higher order behavior. Okay. So all the other contributions, because they are orders of magnitude smaller than this particular contribution, their contributions, while not prevalent at the larger scale, their contributions will come as corrections to the leading order solution. So if this is the leading order solution, accounting for all the other terms will lead to corrections on these equations, but it will not lead to a dramatic deviation in the original behavior of the leading order equation. I mean, this is just an example. It is not related to all of this in any way, but this is just an example. Okay. So finally, we've understood that which terms are important in which equation. So now we can finally write down the dimensionless equations. So the Navier-Stokes equations, and in fact, because we were obtained that this is the dimensionless form of the y momentum equation, we can now recast the original equations in dimensional form so that we can make more physical sense out of them later on. So I'm gonna go ahead and write down the dimensional Navier-Stokes equations based on the equations that we have obtained the dimensionless form. But in order to obtain the dimensionless equations, we have made various simplifying assumptions because of the smallness of epsilon, and we were able to get rid of many terms. So now I'm gonna write down this equation with those drop terms. So you have del u del x plus del v del y equal to 0. Yeah, this is fine. Then we've had u del u del x plus v del u del y is equal to minus 1 by rho del p del x plus nu del 2 u del y 2. and lastly 0 equal to minus del p del y. So these equations are called as Prandtl's boundary layer equation. And what are the boundary conditions? So what are the boundary conditions for this? So at the solid surface, that is at y equal to 0, u equal to 0, and at y equal to delta. Now let us write down first at the solid surface. And v is also equal to 0. At the edge of boundary layer, that is at y equal to delta, u becomes equal to the free stream velocity. It becomes equal to the free stream velocity. And actually, what can we say about these particular equations when applied at the edge of the boundary layer? So remember, once we cross the boundary layer, we no longer have the influence of viscosity. I'm writing no influence, but again, this no influence is at leading order. So this no influence business is also at leading order. In reality, effect of viscosity will be felt at a very large distance as well, but as an engineering estimate, we will say that once we have almost reached the free stream velocity, we will say that there is no influence of viscosity. So at the edge of boundary layer, or rather beyond the boundary layer, viscous term will drop. So this particular term will drop. Moreover, at the edge of boundary layer, there will be no v componential velocity as well. It's simply a incoming free stream velocity. Okay, so at the edge of boundary layer, actually at edge of boundary layer, you just need to drop viscosity. So u del u del x plus v del u del y is equal to minus 1 by rho del p del x. So outside the boundary layer, everything is irrotational. So this you get back the Euler equation. And moreover, because outside the boundary layer the effect of viscosity is not felt, you're not inducing rotationality into the flow. And that means that if the flow is irrotational at the inlet, then the flow also stays irrotational at the outlet. So if there is only a uniform flow coming in, so if the incipient flow is having u infinity velocity, then it will mean that this entire term, so u is not varying with x. Okay, there is no viscosity to retard the flow. And if it's a flow over a flat plate, there is no viscosity to retard this flow. Actually, it need not be a flat plate, it can be any contour. So if the velocity is getting retarded, so if the velocity outside we call capital U as a function of x, okay, then we can write u du dx. So this is this particular term. There will be no y component of velocity, and this will be equal to minus 1 upon rho dp dx. And the reason I can write everything as dp dx is because del p del y is equal to 0, and this implies p is only a function of x. So this equation also holds true outside the boundary layer, and p being only a function of x, it means that whatever pressure, so if you want to find out the pressure at this axial location, whatever is the pressure in the free stream condition, okay, whatever the pressure is in the free stream, that pressure is imposed on the boundary layer. So the interesting thing that comes out from all these equations, all the approximations, is you need to find out the pressure distribution from the Euler equation, and more generally, if you have various simplifying conditions, this actually reduces to the Bernoulli equation. You can integrate this once and get P plus half rho u square equal to constant. So if you are able to find out that the velocity at a certain location x, okay, if you know this location, then you can apply Bernoulli equation between P infinity and U infinity conditions and P and U. And whatever the pressure you obtain through Bernoulli equation is the same pressure that is imposed on top of the viscous boundary layer. Okay, that's the same pressure that is imposed on top of the boundary layer. So that is one key assumption that happens. So if the inviscid velocity distribution is known, you can find out the pressure at any location, and that pressure is imposed throughout. And note that we are sort of recasting everything as u as a function of x. So why is that possible? So that is possible because even if you have a curved object, so if you take the span of the object to be 1 meter, we know that the boundary layer thicknesses will be quite small actually. Okay, the boundary layer thicknesses will be millimeters or so. So let us find out an estimate of the boundary layer thickness. So delta scales at L by square root of Re. So if L is 1 meter and if the Reynolds number is 10 to the power 6, okay, so delta comes out to be 10 to the power minus 3. So if you are analyzing the problem, okay, over this entire span, so if we zoom in to a zone like this, the curvature will sort of vanish. I mean, because you are trying to resolve this thin boundary layer, okay, you are trying to resolve something which is very thin. So once you are zooming in to that location, you essentially do away with the curvature of the base plate. So analysis of the problem as a flat plate has its own merits. You can solve things analytically, but at the same time you can apply many of the learnings from flat plate solutions to flows over curved surfaces. So typically wings and all will be much more than 1 meter. I've kept a very conservative estimate of this, but once again, I mean, this is just a proportionality. This is just to get an order of magnitude. Okay, so this entire discussion, we have obtained all the governing equations so far. We have looked at the underlying simplifications. And now in what follows, we will try to have a simple solution for the boundary layer equations. So that particular approach is what we will study now.